I can see that some people are still coming in. If you're out there in the foyer and you hear our voice, come on in. My name is Dr. Kenneth Hart, in case some of you have never seen me before. We welcome you. I have a class here every Sabbath morning in this location, but that's not why we're here today. We have opened up our facilities here for a very special guest. And I understand that there was a plan to talk about dinosaurs before and after the flood, but our next speaker is going to explain what happened to the dinosaurs. Dr. Brandstetter?
Thank you, Dr. Hart. I'm glad you introduced yourself. There are a few dinosaurs here this morning. Excuse me, but welcome anyway. Several weeks ago, some of you, I'm sure, were here to listen to Dr. John Sanford, who gave us a talk on genetics. Well, our plan was to have another special guest in the form of Dr. Emil Silvestru, and you've seen his name probably. Originally Romanian, now living in British Columbia, Canada, and an expert in geology and cave formation. However, I have to tell you that after arriving in Loma Linda Redlands last Sunday night, and after giving a superb lecture right here on campus at Loma Linda Monday lunchtime, Dr. Silvestru was sitting around the Brandstetter supper table Monday evening and suffered a stroke. If you want to have a stroke, people, come and dine at my house. At least we'll get you to the hospital on time. And although I evoke a smile there, the reality is that the speed with which we did get Dr. Silvestru to the hospital made a big difference, because they were able to quickly diagnose reality and get him started on TPA therapy, which minimizes the effect of the embolism. That's what it was. Anyway, I don't want to dwell on that. It was very troubling to not just to Dr. Silvestru, but his wife, who at this moment, I'm sure, is at his bedside up in the medical center here. You can imagine, with so many people expecting to hear a lecture by Silvestru, we had to find a prominent, noteworthy substitute visitor, and we found one in spades. I'm here to welcome to this place Dr. John Baumgardner. Dr. Baumgardner was a senior physicist at Los Alamos Government Laboratories for 20 years. He is the author and designer of the most sophisticated computer model of planet Earth that, as far as I know, is in existence. He can tell you more about that. But from that work, Dr. Baumgardner was able to develop a theory which is his subject today, the theory of catastrophic plate tectonics. He wasn't satisfied with doing something as original as that. He has made the major contribution to what is known today as Mendel's Accountant, another computer program which Dr. Sanford told us about a few weeks ago, which helped us to unravel what genetic mutations can do, and ultimately what DNA degradation can do to the human race. You will remember that. Well, here is the man here with us this morning who was the brains really behind much of that work. John, you wouldn't say this, but I'm forgiven, aren't I? He told me on the phone yesterday that he is working now on a new project, which is distinct again, but connected with a worldwide global flood catastrophe, which focuses upon the mechanisms for laying down the strata that we know as the geologic column. And in his opinion, presented to me last night humbly, but with not a little confidence, was that this new project may turn out to be even more of an impact than catastrophic plate tectonics. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, I'm glad to welcome a good friend. I've known him for decades now. I know him to be a devout scholar of the Bible and a defender of the biblical record of origins, including a global flood. That's what brings him here today. John, welcome. Before he comes up here and takes to the microphone, I think it is time for us to invite God's presence here. Father in heaven, so much happens to us that's unexpected, as it happened this week to Dr. Silvestro. We ask for your hand to be upon him for quick and generous recovery. We thank you, though, that we now have the privilege of having this guest, Dr. Baumgardner, with us, your servant, truly a man of God, as I can testify. Lord, bless us as we try together today to understand your actions in planet Earth and in the human race and our place in your scheme of things. Lord, we praise your name today and ask your presence among us in Jesus' name. Amen. As you can imagine, this series of events has brought to us some serious financial issues. I'm sorry to be stressing this to you, but we're going to invite our good people to take an offering, if you will come, gentlemen, and we will both help to pay the expenses of Dr. Baumgardner, and also, of course, the family, unexpected family expenses that Dr. Silvestro has met. Thank you. Here is the man himself. Thank you, John.
Thank you for those very kind words, Bernard. I want to give God the glory. Anything that it is worthwhile is a result of his work. And it's a great privilege to serve in this kind of way. And so I'm pleased I can show up on this kind of short notice, 2 days' notice, and hopefully...
Can I interrupt just a second? Can you all hear all right? Are we adjust the mic? Or? I don't know whether it's turned on. Yeah, it's turned on. Let's just see if we can adjust it a little bit more to your... Try that.
Okay. Is that better? Is that better? I want to first say that... My venture into earth science, I was originally trained, my academic training prior to that point was all in electrical engineering and physics. I had not had a single course in earth science. When in the late 70s, as I started to try to understand some of the difficult issues regarding geology and earth history relating to the Bible, I realized that the flood had to be largely a tectonic catastrophe. And at that point, I was with Campus Crusade for Christ. I was living in San Bernardino, and I realized this insight that I suddenly had was extremely important. And I came down to Loma Linda and chatted with Dr. Roth. Ariel Roth here, and it was primarily his counsel that encouraged me to take the step to leave Campus Crusade, enroll at UCLA in a graduate program in earth science, and get a PhD so that I could work on this problem at a professional level. So I credit God's use of Dr. Roth to help steer me in that direction. It was a life-changing decision. At that point. Today I want to talk about the flood. And in my view, there's absolutely no doubt of the reality of a catastrophe, global catastrophe that produced the sediment record, the fossil bearing portion of the sediment record. To me, the evidence is extremely strong that it includes the evidence that these layers internally have evidence of high velocity, high energy water transport. We find essentially no erosional channeling between layers. It and that points to a single cataclysm responsible for the whole record. One layer rapidly laid down on top of another with hardly any topography involved and no erosional channeling. So in my view, the basic evidence of this record itself is enough to establish, if anybody wants to be honest about this record, the reality of a single catastrophic catastrophe that produced all the fossil record. And I believe, this is somewhat controversial perhaps in this room, I believe it goes well up into the Cenozoic, the actual flood. And not only do we have the sediments themselves indicating a flood, but you have a lot of stripping away of these sediments on the continents. All of this material you see here once continued far to the south from this point and has subsequently been stripped away. I believe that was the runoff, result of the runoff of the floodwaters off the continent. And just to affirm that, we see the current surface of the Earth just heavily eroded, heavily channeled. And again, we do not see that sort of thing within this record itself. So again, something, it's the present is not the key to the past in this regard as far as explaining this sediment column. So an obvious implication of the biblical account of the flood is that a staggering amount of geological change took place in the span of only a single year. All of that strata had to be formed during that brief period. Given this reality, what are some of the crucial issues that any satisfactory explanation of the flood must account for? Well, one crucial issue is the youthfulness of today's ocean floor. Based on many separate independent methods for dating the ocean basement rocks and the ocean floor sediments, the entire modern ocean floor is young, younger than much of the continental fossil record. And this realization was key to my epiphany I had in the late 70s. In that regard, that referring back to that earlier slide, all of the modern day ocean floor has formed since this point in the continental stratigraphic record. So all of this part of the record, which includes many roughly almost a mile of fossil bearing sediment rocks in the Grand Canyon, occurred prior to any of today's ocean floor being on the surface of the planet. Okay, now how does new ocean floor form? Well, in today's world, it forms along what is called a mid-ocean ridge, depicted here. And basically, what happens is as the tectonic plates on either side of the ridge pull apart, magma rises to fill that gap. Generally locally, in this local region, magma rises to fill the gap because of what is known as decompression melting. The melting temperature of rock depends on pressure. As the pressure decreases, the melting temperature decreases. So rock that had been solid a little, say 100 kilometers down, as it rises up, some of the minerals find themselves above their melting temperatures and begin to melt, and there's partial melting takes place, produces basalt, and rises and fills the gap. So that's how new ocean crust is formed in the Earth today. I believe that same process operated during the flood and produced all the present-day ocean crust. The age of the modern ocean floor, which became clear for the first time in the 1960s, implies that the flood had to involve large-scale tectonic change. Tectonic change of the scale that recycled all the present, all the pre-flood ocean floor into the Earth's interior and caused continents to migrate by thousands of miles across the face of the Earth. So just the logic of it, the logic of the flood, the logic in folding in the age of the ocean floor implies that the flood had to be, logically had to be, a tectonic catastrophe. The resulting explanation for the large-scale tectonic change associated with the Genesis flood has come to be known by the term catastrophic plate tectonics. And this conceptual framework was first introduced at the first International Conference on Creation held in Pittsburgh in 1986. So this has been out in the public view since 1986. All right, so what are some of the highlights of catastrophic plate tectonics? Well, before I address that, let's just help make sure everybody's up to speed on the structure of the interior of the Earth. You can divide the Earth into two main parts: the core, which is mostly molten iron, and the mantle, which is mostly solid silicate rock. So the outer part of the Earth is silicate rock. It's solid, except for small little pockets in a few places. It's all solid. The uppermost part of the mantle is thin and cold and mechanically rigid, known as the lithosphere. Lithos for rock in Greek. And this outer skin of the Earth is known as the lithosphere, and it's broken up into about a dozen large plates. Just below the lithosphere is a much weaker asthenosphere, about 1,000, in some cases 10,000 times weaker than this layer above it. So this lithospheric layer broken up into plates is mechanically decoupled from the mantle below and is able to move relatively freely over the deeper mantle. Catastrophic plate tectonics is very similar to conventional plate tectonics, except that plate velocities are about a billion times higher, about 5 miles an hour instead of 2 inches per year. The present rate's about 2 inches a year, about the rate your fingernails grow. Whereas back during the flood, the plates were moving on the order of 5 miles per hour. All right, the frames I have summarize how the continents have moved since multicellular life first became fossilized in the rocks, as reconstructed by the secular earth science community. And these particular slides were produced by Professor Ron Blakey of Northern Arizona University, available on the internet. Only stipulation is that you credit him with where the slides came from. Okay, and so in this reconstruction, what would correspond to the onset of the flood, this is what his reconstruction of the continent distribution is. And then as you move forward in time, you see the three blocks break away, which is North America, Western Europe, and Siberia, or Laurentia, Baltica, and Siberia. Okay, and then, they move apart, they slam together. Eventually you have Pangaea formed roughly at the end of the Paleozoic time. And then you have a breakup of Pangaea to get us to the present day. Ice age following, which would be following the flood, and the present. So I think I'll just go through that again, just back up. So we have, let me emphasize, all of this motion, all of this tectonic change, logically having to unfold during the year of the flood. Now, I'm just repeating myself, with the fossils, If the fossils represent life forms present in the pre-flood world, which were destroyed in the flood, then all the plate motion summarized in the preceding sequence must have unfolded during the year of the flood. That's the that interval is the interval in which multicellular fossils were deposited, were formed, buried in the sediment record. Now, it's my conviction that his initial reconstruction was geometry was off by roughly 90 degrees. Instead of being centered, this initial configuration centered at the South Pole, I believe it had to be near the equator, because the kind of life we see in the fossil record, much of it is has tropical sorts of affinity. And so I can't imagine the center of the pre-flood world being at the South Pole. It had to be, in my view, near the equator, as you as shown here. And instead of this, where the center is the South Pole here in his reconstruction with a big ice cap. So, but that's relatively minor. Otherwise, I believe the reconstruction, there's good reasons for something like that to have been the actual case. Okay. Now again, in the case of catastrophic plate tectonics, the ocean plates can slide in the mantle and sink because they are cooler and denser than the mantle rock beneath. So this rock making up the ocean lithosphere, actually, because it's cold primarily, and it has a very similar chemical composition, it's denser and able to sink. Now, rapid plate motion can occur because mantle rock weakens under stress. That's an experimentally demonstrated aspect of the way rocks deform. So in catastrophic plate tectonics, you have the plates falling at meters per second instead of a few centimeters per year. All right. So catastrophic plate tectonics, like conventional plate tectonics, accounts for many of the Earth's physical features, including the mid-ocean ridges, the high heat flow above the mid-ocean ridges, vigorous hydrothermal activity along the mid-ocean ridges. And just to summarize, it accounts for the mid-ocean ridges, the high heat flow, and the same things that conventional plate tectonics explain. And just to give you some idea that rock does behave in this way, this is a lava lake in northeastern Ethiopia, and you see as this rock basalt cools, it becomes dense and sinks near the edge of this lake, and you see it as it rises, it cools so fast it splits apart. An analogy to what the mid-ocean ridge would be. So in a micro scale, almost laboratory scale, you see this process actually occurring on the Earth today in a lava lake. All right. Other features, both catastrophic plate tectonics and regular plate tectonics, account for the absence of sediment at the mid-ocean ridges, fracture zones, I'll point to that, symmetry of the mid-Atlantic ridge. Okay, so the fracture zone, fracture zones offset segments of the mid-ocean ridge, and so plate tectonics is about the only theory that can account for these fracture zones. And as far as the symmetry, we have this remarkable symmetry of the ocean floor on either side of the mid-Atlantic ridge. Catastrophic plate tectonics also explains the deep ocean trenches, the global distribution of earthquakes, the inclined zone of high earthquake activity adjacent to the trenches, zones of volcanism adjacent to the trenches, in some cases expressed as island arcs, in other cases as continental volcanoes. Where there's a trench where the plates are plunging into the earth, There's the trench. There are earthquakes in this deforming plate. There's melting where water is carried down. Water lowers the melting temperature of rock, And when it gets down to this kind of depth, there's substantial melting that produces volcanism, the ring of fire around the Pacific today. So both kinds of plate tectonics account for these phenomena. And the reality of plate tectonics today, if people are skeptical, these magnitude earthquakes that have, 9 earthquakes that have taken place, one just a year ago, should remove most of that doubt. The Pacific plate in one jumped about, there was a displacement of about 50 feet in a segment of that fault here beneath Japan, producing that magnitude 9 earthquake and just a catastrophic tsunami. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. All right. I'll fix that. Sorry. I am teachable, so anything you want to correct me on, I welcome. Okay. All right, this is a map from NASA showing the location of earthquakes between 1980 and 1995. And they are dominated by they occur predominantly along the plate boundaries, as you see here, especially where subduction is taking place along in the eastern Pacific, northwestern Pacific, well, around the Pacific Ring of Fire. Okay, so plate tectonics, both varieties account for the active volcanoes in the world today. Again, the Ring of Fire and other places along plate boundaries. All right, now, but what are some distinctive geological consequences of catastrophic plate tectonics? Things that the conventional kind of plate tectonics doesn't have. Well, one thing is that when this process unfolds rapidly, you have supersonic steam jets emerging from the seafloor along 40,000 miles or more of rapidly spreading mid-ocean rift zones. And you're also going to get intense global rain from the entrenched ocean water lofted above the Earth by these steam jets. So as these plates are pulling apart, where the separation velocity may be something like 10 miles an hour, each plate moving at about 5 miles an hour, you're basically going to have this region elevated much higher than you would otherwise. You're going to have a lot more basalt production, a lot more magma, molten magma in direct contact with ocean water. And the energy is sufficient to create steam. You're going to get supercritical steam, which very, very quickly, or supercritical water, which flashes to steam, and the energy is sufficient to get velocities several thousand miles per hour. So you're going to get supersonic velocity. Jets easily ripping through the layer of ocean water above it, through the atmosphere into the stratosphere. And these jets are going to entrain ocean water, liquid ocean water, as they come up through the ocean and carry that water into the stratosphere. And so this solves a problem of where the rain could come from for 40 days and 40 nights. A problem in the past has been, if you do the energetics, you can't condense water that rapidly. The temperature of the top of the atmosphere would have to approximate that of the sun in order to radiate away the latent heat that's needed to condense the water. In this case, the water that produces the rain never is in vapor form. It's in liquid form, lofted by these steam jets. And so we read in Genesis, in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, on the 17th day of the month, on the same day, all the fountains of the great deep burst open, and the floodgates of the skies were opened, and the rain fell upon the earth for 40 days and 40 nights. As far as I know, this is the only mechanism that explains can explain that phenomenon, and it's associated with the rapid seafloor spreading and the production of these supersonic steam jets. Other things distinctive to catastrophic plate tectonics: one is an elevated sea level because of the warmer rock below the seafloor near a ridge. The rapid replacement of the pre-flood ocean floor that was presumably colder and denser with hot young ocean floor causes the average temperature of the rock beneath the oceans to be higher. Therefore, that rock less dense, displacing a significant volume of the oceans and causing the global sea level to be higher. Also, with all this motion in the mantle, you get strong up and down motions of the continental surfaces. And then as this whole process shuts down and the things that had caused the continent margins to be depressed, those forces go away and you get dramatic uplift of today's mountain belts at the end of the cataclysm, which currently cannot be explained in conventional plate tectonics. So this is a little cartoon attempting to illustrate many of these main features. You have the old sinking cold ocean floor sinking mostly beneath a continent, pulling the continent down. You have new ocean floor being produced, which is hotter and less dense, displacing much of the volume of the ocean, causing the global sea level to rise. You have the steam jets, and you have the intense global rain as that water that's been entrained falls back to the earth. Now, just a little more on what happens when this happens quickly. When this plate is sinking very quickly, just like a rock dropped in a bucket of tar, there is a depression of the surface as that dense material sinks, causes the edge of the continent to be pulled down by several miles and thus temporarily lie below sea level. So as this dynamically is going on, there is a depression of the edge of the continent where adjacent to where subduction is taking place. However, following the episode, all this rapid subduction, the driving force vanishes. The buoyancy takes over, and in most cases these zones have been thickened. The layer of buoyant light crustal rock has increased in thickness. Buoyancy takes over and causes a mountain belt to rise. And it's interesting that all the mountains in the world today have risen, for the most part, in the Pliocene and Pleistocene very recently, very much out of phase from what conventional plate tectonics would predict. I believe it's this disconnect in the timing of when the mountain belts rose is a strong argument in favor of catastrophic plate tectonics. Here, a photo of the Chilean Andes, and all of these mountains are very young, have been uplifted in the last few million years of geologic time, in the last few thousand years of real time since the flood. In addition, there was an ice age that followed the flood. The warming of the oceans during the flood led to high rates of evaporation, precipitation, and rapid buildup of polar ice sheets and mountain glaciers following the flood. And we had these ice sheets as depicted here, that they're a logical consequence of this kind of cataclysm. All right, so a crucial issue here is how can ocean plates sink vertically through 1,800 miles of mantle rock in a few weeks' time? Just how, you know, what physics could possibly allow that to happen? And I've already indicated that we're in order for all this to work, you've got to have plates sinking on the orders of meters per second. Well, for the last roughly 50 years, since around 1960s, labs around the world have been measuring the deformation properties of silicate minerals. And this is a lab set up from Paris, back from that vintage from about 40, 50 years ago. This is an oven here where the temperature is controlled. The sample is in the middle. It's compressed via these silica rods, and they can apply a fixed amount of stress to those, to the sample. And then afterward, the sample can be looked at in an electron microscope, and you can actually see planes of atoms that have slid over one another like decks of cards as a result of the deformation. And so this how silicates deform under stress at various temperatures has been well studied in many laboratories across the world. And I don't want to intimidate you with this complex slide, other than to point out that this data is a summary, summarizes experiments from many laboratories, and what it shows is that minerals can deform by rates varying over 10 orders of magnitude, more than a billion, depending on what the stress levels are. Relatively small range in stress can produce incredible ranges of deformation rates in silicate minerals that make up the mantle. So the physics is there, that rocks deform dramatically under stress, especially when they're at a moderate fraction of their melting temperature. So what I have done in this next these next slides is put that experimental data into a computer program using engineering technology, the finite element method, to look at what the consequences are when you use that real rheology. And this is a snapshot from the calculation. The thickness corresponds to the Earth's mantle. Color denotes temperature. In this case, the temperature range is from roughly 300 degrees Kelvin, roughly room temperature at the surface, and something like 3,800 Kelvin at the base, which would correspond to the core mantle boundary. And I have a blob of material up here at the top, and because the runaway kicks in so quickly, this is it's already up to 4 meters per second after 2 days of into the simulation. And this shows it at 5 days, and this is after 15 days. And this is after 40 days. A large fraction of the coal material that had been on the surface is now at the base of the mantle. Note that the energy driving this process is simply the gravitational potential energy associated with the initial temperature differences. This material has gravitational potential energy because it's cold and heavy relative to the bottom. The stuff on the bottom is light, is hot and buoyant, and has gravitational potential energy relative to the surface. So those two volumes of rock basically have exchanged places, and all that motion has been driven by that release of gravitational potential energy. So here is a little movie of that calculation, showing that the physics really does work. The 2D simulation, though it may not seem that complex or impressive, demonstrates that the physics indeed works. Specifically, that stress weakening in rocks can produce catastrophic consequences in a planet with the gravity field of the Earth. The Earth's gravity is strong enough to produce stresses in the range needed for this effect to operate. All right, and in graduate school at UCLA, my PhD thesis, it was God's hand that brought this about. It enabled me to build a 3D model of the Earth's interior for my main thesis research. And this shows a cutaway view of the spherical grid that I used. This code now is known as Terra and is used in research groups in many places around the world, still used. I'm not going to spend a lot of time, but this is the animation we looked at earlier going back in time, So if we go take this back in time, I'm going to start it at not at the beginning, but roughly midway through the flood, when the continents were together in what is known as Pangaea. So this is another reconstruction of Pangaea, and this is my crude reconstruction of the present day continents into a Pangaean like configuration. So this represents the initial condition in my calculation. In addition, I've put a ring of cold material around much of the boundary of that pre-flood of that Pangaean supercontinent, plus a strip of cold material running down through present-day southeastern Asia down into Australia. And it's approximately 400 degrees colder than the surrounding material to a depth of 400 kilometers. So since I don't know what the density distribution was in the Earth at that point, I just use this simple initial condition to get the calculation going, to get some motion going. But despite the simplicity of that initial condition, it turns out that it pulls these continent blocks apart and causes them to migrate in approximately the right directions. Antarctica to the south, Australia in this direction, India and Africa that way, South America away from Africa, North America away from Africa and Eurasia. And so this is after 25 days into the simulation. Also shows new ocean floor being formed in these warmer colors here. This is a slice through the equator showing the sinking of the cold material below where I was initiating getting the calculation started. That has continued and is causing the mantle to overturn, basically. This is a snapshot after 40 days. The time scale is not all that critical. I can just by tweaking one parameter, but I've chosen it so it has a reasonable time scale. Here you have, by this time, have Africa colliding with Eurasia. And anyway, the velocities, the motions are correspond amazingly well with what geology indicates the plate motions have been. This is an equatorial slice showing this cold material starting to spread out over the core mantle boundary. This is showing the hot ocean, hot upper mantle, hot lithosphere in the new ocean that's formed. A view from the North Pole, view from the South Pole, Antarctica basically going roughly in the right direction. I just show that to say that is possible to do numerical simulations that generally give the behavior of what we know has happened. And I'll say this is no one else in the secular community has reproduced this. There are some other codes, but none of them with this kind of capability. All right, so what about, is there any evidence to support catastrophic plate tectonics? Well, the answer is yes. Seismic images of the mantle reveal a ring of anomalously cold rock at the bottom of the mantle, beneath the subduction zones that surround the Pacific Ocean. And this is from what is called seismic tomography. The blue represents cold material, the red hot material. And this is a view from the Western Hemisphere. This is Japan here, North America over here. This ring of cold material. and the red is the hot material squeezed up like toothpaste in the middle as this cold material has sunk. The big problem is that the difference inferred between these two blobs is on the order of about 3,000 centigrade, and conventional plate tectonics, it takes about 100 million years for a plate to get to the bottom of the mantle. By that time, it would have warmed up considerably. This temperature difference would mean that the temperature of this material is not that much different from lithosphere at the Earth's surface today. So it's an argument that this material has sunk to the bottom of the mantle very recently, thousands, not hundreds of millions of years ago. Additional observational support for catastrophic plate tectonics, what are called ultra-high pressure minerals, like quartzite and diamond, found in many tectonic belts around the world, testify to the reality of crustal rock being subducted to depths of 100 to 300, or in many cases more, and then rapidly brought back up to the surface. This is a photograph of quartzite, a phase of quartz, inside a zircon, indicating something very strange, very unusual, has happened to produce these ultra-high-pressure minerals. In addition, they're what are known as super faults, where rock has melted. The rate of deformation has been so rapid that rock has melted. And these are known in many places, and more examples of this are being discovered. This secular scientist Spray defined this term superfault back in 1997. And he mentioned displacements are estimated to range from 100 meters to 10 kilometers per single slip event. So he's arguing that there's evidence that in a single slip event, the faults have slipped by 10 kilometers, 6 miles in a single event. I would argue there are evidences for much bigger slips even than that, especially in Alaska where we've looked. Moreover, observations suggest that a mantle runaway cataclysm occurred not long ago inside the planet Venus. The NASA Magellan mission to Venus in the early 1990s revealed that a catastrophic resurfacing event had occurred via processes inside the planet in the relatively recent past. Much of the Venus surface is what is called the gridded plains formed by massive basalt flows, covering the surface, obliterating all the previous craters that may have existed, leaving it relatively smooth. These bright features are fractures in the basalt that formed as the basalt cooled. About the only recent features since that event are about 1,000 impact craters, most of which are pristine. The ejecta blanket shows no evidence of any degradation, as if these craters had happened just yesterday. And the reason that's generally understood that this event had to be recent in the Venus history. This is a set of three impact craters with fresh ejecta blankets. Probably one object came in and broke up in the dense Venus atmosphere and produced three pieces that produced those three adjacent craters. Now let's shift gears. I'm going to really speed through. I'm getting to the end of my time. Let's shift gears a bit and consider another extremely important issue, that of the thick sediment sequences which blanket the Earth's continents. How can so much sediment be transported and deposited in a time span of only a few months? That boggles the mind, doesn't it? Or not? Am I the only one that has trouble imagining how that could happen? Let me offer a new mechanism. In 2006, as I was grappling with trying to understand the continental motions during the early portion of the flood, I realized the Earth may well have been rotationally unstable during the flood as a consequence of changes in the distribution of mass in the Earth as the plates were rapidly sinking to the bottom. Such a state of instability leads to multiple rotations of the original North Pole and South Pole and back again, with the Earth flipping over and over like a top. And this kind of motion, rotational motion of any rigid body is described by what are called the Euler equations discovered in the mid-1700s by Leonard Euler. And so this is from a class on this phenomenon at MIT. I'm just saying this shows the geometry for the equations. These are the equations. I don't want to intimidate you by the equations, but they're actually relatively simple here. The M's are the torques acting on the body. In the case of the Earth spinning in space, there are no torques, so all these are zero. And but these are nonlinear equations. The rate of change in the spin rate depends on the product of the spin rates about the other two orthogonal axes. So it's an interesting set of equations. Possible to program, it only took me an afternoon to program those on the computer and start getting solutions. What sort of initial condition might lead to this kind of instability? One possibility would be a ring of cold material in the upper mantle, but that is precisely the sort of pre-flood initial condition I've been using in my catastrophic plate tectonic simulations. As I showed earlier, this is roughly a ring around a great circle in the Earth, and what results at the bottom is roughly a ring along a great circle in the Earth. So in this case, the spin would be through an axis through the plane of that circle of rock, and So I programmed that using those initial conditions. It's possible to solve the Euler equations numerically, obtain solutions that display this behavior. And so here's an animation sequence, and let me try to help you follow what's going on. I've put a red spot at the geographical North Pole, a yellow spot at the geographical South Pole, and I have a green spot, along the equator, just to help you see what's going on. Now, I show two views here. One is that if you're just at a fixed point in space looking at the Earth, and that one is not as helpful as this one. This is the geostationary view, like a geostationary satellite, like a weather satellite that rotates around the Earth once every 24 hours and is able to stay above the same point as the Earth rotates. The satellite rotates along with the Earth once a day. And so this helps you see what's going on with the Earth and takes out the Earth's 24-hour rotation. So in this sequence that's going to follow, I urge you to look at this one. So this is one snapshot. This is one slightly later. You can see the green spot in the left figure moving, whereas the green spot in the other one is hardly moving. All right. So here's the animation. You can see the Earth, the North Pole flipping down to where the South Pole was. Okay, and this is the time, 12 days, 13, so on. So this thing flips about on the order of four times during the main phase of the flood, the way I've got the parameters set. And it's driven, again, by the change, by what's going on inside the Earth. Okay, I think we've played enough of that. My time's getting short here. Each vertical line represents one flip of the Earth. I won't go into that. We can also test this numerical result experimentally. A friend in my church is an engineer. He wanted to do an experiment, see if we could reproduce this with an experiment. So we looked for balls that were very symmetric. We found that billiard balls had the best symmetry of any kind of ball we could purchase. So what we did was put the extra, put some extra mass in the billiard ball, took about 3/4 inch pieces of brass welding rod, inserted them at 12 equally spaced locations around a great circle to give us that extra mass. And then we levitated the ball using air to minimize the friction. I did that with my shop vac. And so this will show the, I'm just going to show you the billiard ball with the pieces of brass welding rod in it. Let me turn off my sound here. Well, I forget how to turn off my, I got it. Okay. So that's what the billiard ball looks like. And this shows it being supported in a ABS pipe fitting with my shop vac connected. And the air causes the ball to rotate. In this case, the axis is horizontal, not vertical. I forgot to mention I paid in one end of the ball with a white spot with a black spot in the middle to denote one pole, and then no black spot on the other end. So you're going to see the ends of the billiard ball exchange places here. Okay, I need to click on this. So here you see this moving away from the pole, and the white spot on the other end moving toward the equator. Now they're both going basically around the equator. The white spot moving down to the other pole, to this pole. Okay. And then they move back again. Just like the computer simulation showed. You know, some people don't trust computer results. So this is for those of you that are in that category. It's the air. It's the there's enough asymmetry in the ball to cause it to spin one direction in preference to the other. Okay, so I think you get the idea there. All right, how would such rotational dynamics affect the water in the oceans? Can you imagine what the oceans would do if the Earth flipped like that? Well, I'll give you a hint what it happens. It produces gigantic swirling masses of water thousands of feet in depth that migrate over the continents. Super tsunamis. Instead of the tsunamis being a few tens of feet high, we have them like 1,000 feet or 2,000 feet high. And not instead of moving at, you know, 10 miles an hour, the water, the free velocity is on the order of a couple of hundred miles an hour. Now, just to help you understand why that is likely, right now, the Earth rotates once every 24 hours. The circumference of the Earth is about 25,000 miles. So on the equator, the water and the people and buildings, everything is moving at about 1,000 miles an hour to the east. Now, if you suddenly move the equator up to the North Pole where it's not moving at all, you've changed the velocity of everything by 1,000 miles an hour. So it's not surprising that, you know, some of the water's all of a sudden going to find a continent in its way where it hadn't been in its way before. And you can well imagine water spilling up over the continent. Okay. All right. So here is Here are some snapshots from a simulation I've done. This is with a computer program I developed while I was at Los Alamos. Solves the shallow water equations on a rotating sphere with the variable topography. And so I have I've put a single circular continent on the sphere that's and the water depth initially without any rotation is 100 meters, 300 feet. So that it's flooded by 300 feet of water. Elsewhere, the water depth is about 12,000 feet. I use a view where the camera is centered above the continent at all time. So you're taking out all of the rotation and other things. So you're just centered over the continent. We're simply interested in how much water, what's going on above the continent. The color denotes the height of the water height above nominal sea level. So the maximum value is 900 meters, which is approaching 3,000 feet. And the minimum shown here is 100 meters, it's the original surface height of the continent. And so the velocities are going to range beyond the order of a couple of hundred meters per second. So that's one snapshot. You see this swirling mass of water this way. One thing is that when these blobs of water occur when the continent is near one of the poles, in this case the South Pole. And when it gets around, when it flips the other way, the direction, the rotation direction is opposite. So these are for meteorologists in the room, these are like high pressure regions, so the rotation is clockwise in the northern hemisphere, counterclockwise in the southern hemisphere. So this is a little later in the sequence. This is just showing, this is snapshots a day apart, showing how these things move from day to day. All right, now this is the animation. This is the time and days, 35, 36, 37. So here's a blob. Here's another blob, the one we just looked at. Here's another blob. Here's yet another big blob, and they wrote their opposite in polarity and direction, and this is the last one after about 190 days. Then I start this sequence over again. So what are some consequences? Astonishing consequences. The rotational instability of the mantle during the flood appears to provide a potent means of generating large-scale currents on the continents capable of transporting and depositing vast quantities of sediment demanded by the stratigraphic record. What are the next steps? Work is underway to add an erosion and sediment transport and deposition model to the shallow water program currently used. The output from this enhanced program will be a layered sediment sequence over the continental regions. So we can run this simulation, look at what that the sediment pattern is, and ask, is there any resemblance to what we see today? So I'm very eager to see what the answer is going to be. So what is the takeaway message? Well, the Genesis flood was real, radically transformed the face of the earth. Should be obvious. And I'll just meekly say it appears feasible to apply scientific methods to gain insight into some of the important physical aspects of the cataclysm. So I believe this kind of work is worthwhile. And finally, compared with God's wisdom, we're hardly scratching the surface. As the Apostle Paul says, "Oh, the depths of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and unfathomable his ways." Thank you very much. I apologize. I've not left any time for questions. Bernard, I told Bernard, to get through this. He wanted me to speak on this particular topic. And I said, I need an hour. I need a full hour. So,
Very good. But before you run away, let's close with a word of prayer. Our kind and loving Father, what a wonderful insight into what may have happened a few thousand years ago and how it might have affected our Earth. We thank Dr. Baumgardner for being here. We thank you for life and health and this present Sabbath day. Be with us through the rest of these hours is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
We have another class starting here in about 15 minutes, but there's a card available out on the table regarding where you can get this lecture tomorrow on the internet.
I also forgot to give you my website. If some of you really interested, I'll give you my business card. I just have a few here.
You raise a lot of questions. Nowhere in your lecture, you explain everything with a physical model. Nowhere is the hand of deity. So the question I would have is, what?
It had to get out into deep water quickly if it's going to survive.
The tsunami and with this kind of thing, right. No ark would have survived.
Yeah, it had to be away from the continent, out in the deep water, for the ark to survive.
And secondly, how could the Earth, after all of this catastrophe, return to a stable enough form so that civilization could produce enough grapes for Noah to get drunk a year later?
That's a good question.
It wouldn't return to stability that quick.
Basically,
stability restored.
That's right.
The what I do is put a little damping in. There's topography on the core mantle boundary. The core mantle boundary is not perfectly smooth. The core would have kept rotating in its original rotation. So there would be friction between the mantle and the core. And so there's without it using any extreme value, there's enough friction there to slow this flipping. Also, the thing that was responsible for the flipping, the imbalance in the Earth has gone away since that coal material is now at the core mantle boundary. So I'm able to have that flipping slow down, so that toward the end of the flood, it was almost gone. And some of you may have heard of this guy Dodwell in Australia, who thinks the Earth still had some motion, flipping motion, still had in addition to the wobble that we observe, still had some residual rotation about that axis during later human history. So I suspect that it didn't completely come to a stop during the flood, but in the centuries following, it damped out. Right. I didn't take time to talk about the flipping of the magnetic field, but the characteristics of that, it turns out that, I just didn't have time to go into it, but
can I interrupt? We want to get this recorded, so we're going to have you all sit down and raise your hand, and you'll get a chance to raise your questions, because there's no reason for not everybody able to hear. No, you got a mic already. I'll give this to them. We have three or four mics, so we can get to everybody.
I think this is my last one.
Okay. Were you in the middle of somebody's question?
Let me just see if I have. I think I gave them all away. Yeah, I did. That was my last one.
Yeah. I have a couple of questions. Number one, are you familiar with the work on paleocurrents done by Arthur Chadwick?
Yes.
And are you able to integrate them, or are you working on integrating them with the flipping that you're doing right now?
Let me repeat the question. The question is, am I aware of the paleocurrent work being done by Art Chadwick? And yes, I've known of that for decades. At some point, I've talked with him, it was about a year ago, saying we ought to sit down and get together, let me show you my results. And we discuss, you know, what is the degree of correlation? And I'll say that we have not yet gotten together, but I've verbally described what I'm getting. He's very interested, and hopefully sometime in the near future we will try to start working together. But at this point, what I'm seeing is a reversal in directions from one flip to the other. Also, what I'm with this particular choices of parameters, I'm getting 6 blobs of water over the continent during the course of the flood, and that corresponds amazingly with the fact that there are 6 mega sequences in the sediment record described by Sloss in the 1960s, with a continent-wide, actually global, unconformity separating these 6 packages of sediment known as the mega sequences. So this model already seems to explain some fairly significant aspects of the larger sedimentary record, namely this mega sequence aspect of the record. Okay.
The second question is, have you worked with trying to integrate any of the meteorite impacts that have been found, say Chilix Caber, Chesapeake Bay, into the model that you're working with?
Okay. My view is that while the question had to do with meteor impacts and how they relate to what I was showing today. While I believe there are enough impacts in flood-aged rocks to indicate an enhanced rate of impact during the flood, I do not think these impacts had any significant effect on the overall dynamics of what I was talking about. So. You know, there are some creationists that want to invoke impacts to explain everything. I believe that simply does not work. So my tendency is to minimize the effect of impacts, but quite honestly, I do not think they played a significant role. The Chicxulub impact, was a pretty big impact, and it probably left an iridium signature. But it was not the cause of the demise of the dinosaurs.
I'm very impressed with your presentation. I had no idea somebody was working so hard on these things. My question would be, if the tsunamis were so huge, how did Noah and his ark manage to survive?
There's a cryptic phrase in verse 1 of chapter 8 in Genesis, and it says, that phrase is, but God remembered Noah. and so, you know, as far as physical issues are concerned, I believe that somehow the ark had to get to deep water quickly before all this dynamic started to happen. Because the intensity of the tsunamis is limited to the continental area. If you're out in the deeper ocean, the amplitude of the tsunami-like waves is relatively small. It's a function of the depth of the water. The deeper the water, the smaller the amplitude of the surface wave. And so I would think that almost certainly Noah, the ark, had to be during the flood, had to be in deeper water, not over continental craton.
Yes, I have a question about the core. How is heat caused and maintained? And another question is, what happened to, what about the moon, the relationship to all this phenomenon? as well.
I didn't quite understand your first question about the core.
Well, how is heat caused and maintained so deep into the earth?
What is the source of heat inside
yes.
the earth?
Yes, yes.
Well, the simple answer I would give is that the heat we see today inside the earth is almost certainly mostly the original heat in the earth that existed after creation. So that the earth was hot inside after creation, and it continues to be hot. There's just no way to move that heat to the surface. So the most of the heat inside the earth it goes back to creation week. And I've already forgotten your second question.
How about the moon?
The moon. In this framework, the moon would not be affected. The moon, the way the Earth interacts with the moon, Earth interacts with the moon is primarily by its gravity, and the Earth's gravity is not affected by all this flipping motion and catastrophic plate tectonics. The gravity field of the Earth is essentially unaffected, so it would have no effect on the moon.
Okay, two-part question. What do you date the flood at?
Okay, I have to say I don't have a hard position on that. My preference is simply to take the Masoretic text at face value, give it precedence over, say, the Septuagint, and that would place the flood roughly 2350 BC. Mm-hmm. But I really don't know why the translators of the Septuagint seem to have played fast and loose with some of the numbers in the genealogies in Genesis, whether they had some information that we don't know about or not. Just as my default position, I go with the Masoretic text.
Okay. How would you put ice core data, incorporate that into your model?
Okay. Question has to do with ice cores. Generally, a lot of people are not aware that the distinct layers in the ice cores disappear fairly quickly. And so the instead of having yearly layers evident, all that you have is markers are layers of volcanic ash or dust to mark layers. This yearly layering, it only goes back a few thousand layers, and after that you don't have those kind of layers in the ice cores, so that you have to use other means for getting dates for those portions of the ice core. So that's the way I treat it, that the accumulation of the ice sheets was rapid after the flood, and so that there was a rapid buildup of ice in Greenland and Antarctica at the end of the flood. But that and so there is, you know, you're sampling ice. I mean, it was in place quickly in probably in the first century or so after the flood. And you do not find any yearly signal in that in those portions of the core.
Okay. Do you assume that conditions were static before the flood?
What do you mean by static?
The continents were relatively stable, yes. Not much in the way of tectonic activity.
My guess is, in trying to model all of this, I'm guessing that it may not have been so steady in the months and maybe even years, a few years leading up to the catastrophe. I believe there may well have been some, whatever, birth pangs. There may have been some premonition that there something was about to happen, so that those people in Noah's day were even more culpable for rejecting Noah's message, because there were physical signs that something may have been about to happen. So I suspect there were some physical signs that something was going on before God shut the door on the ark.
So you're suspecting that there was some significant tectonic activity to create the cold ring?
No, the cold ring was there. I didn't mention that. I should have. I believe that cold ring was there at the end of creation. So the potential for this catastrophe was there, built in. I believe that had Adam never sinned, this, you know, the catastrophe never would have happened. The things that had to get set in motion would never have set in motion. I might mention, in modeling this flipping, unless I put a perturbation in, even though the initial configuration is unstable, theoretically unstable, if there's no perturbation to kick it into that mode, it will rotate forever, you know, go on happily forever without ever doing any flipping. So there's got to be something that pushes it toward that state.
Define perturbation?
A slight nudge. Okay, I'll call it that, a slight nudge.
Okay.
Okay, back there.
We know there's a slight wobble in the rotational axis. We know that there, in recent history, there has been a drastic change in the axis. And we know that in your dissertation that it has flipped. That's old history. My question is there any evidence as to which happened, the egg or the chicken, the flip or the Teutonic slip?
Okay. I think you may be confusing reversals in the magnetic field direction with physical flipping of the Earth. Those are not the same. The Earth's magnetic field is connected with currents inside the Earth's core, these currents, they're electric currents, and so in general, they're not associated with mass moving at all. They're simply electric currents flowing in the core that generates a magnetic field. It's just like a solenoidal magnet, just like electric magnet. Okay, so. For the most part, at least at some level, there's no connection between the flipping that I'm talking about and a reversal in the magnetic field direction. So I think that answers most of that your concern.
Most of this has been viewing retroactively. If we were to look ahead, apparently in the Mayan record, there is indication that they felt that at this year, there would be some catastrophic event that would cause something like this to happen again. Has that ever been looked at? Have you looked in that area at all? That goes way off into another whole area, I'm sure.
No, I can't say that I have delved into that particular possibility.
How good is your model at predicting the future?
Well, based on scripture, I'm I'm comforted that God's not going to bring another catastrophe like that one on the earth. Although there are some things in Scripture that would might prompt some people to buy fire insurance. But I don't think that kind of fire insurance would do much good.
Regarding the axes of the Earth, would the shorter north-south axes act to stabilize against this rotation, or would it just tend to dampen it out over time?
Okay. The fact that the Earth is spinning and the fact that the Earth is deformable results in a bulge, equatorial bulge. That means the distance from the center of the Earth to the north and south poles is less than it is out to the equator. It turns out that it took me a while to sort this out myself, but when the Earth flips, the bulge. The Earth is deformable enough where the bulge will track, will go where it needs to go. So it doesn't, the Earth isn't strong enough for it to retain that bulge even in the time scale as fast as I was showing those flips taking place. So what that means is you can neglect the bulge in these calculations. At first I didn't. It didn't make a big difference, but then I realized as I looked into it, I concluded that you can completely neglect that effect of the bulge.
Now, if the Earth's magnetic field is caused by electrons going around in a particular plane, will that magnetic field maintain itself in the same general direction through all of these flips? In which case, if the mantle is moving around it, would that cause reversals of magnetic polarity simply because of the mantle moving around the core?
Right. I didn't take time to talk about the connection between the Earth's magnetic field and these flips, and I have lots of slides where I deal with that. I believe the flipping of the Earth did cause the magnetic reversals. And, you know, one thing that's interesting in the literature regarding magnetic reversals, there are what are called virtual VGP, virtual geomagnetic reversal paths. It appears that there's enough data been collected. It appears that during a magnetic reversal, there's a preferred path that is taken when the field transitions from being pointing north to pointing south, and these VGP paths basically there are two of them. They're basically follow a line of longitude, a meridian. And one of them is in the western Pacific, and the other one is through North and South America. They're 180 degrees apart. They correspond exactly to they're above this ring of cold material in the bottom of the mantle, and they correlate perfectly with the kind of flipping motion that I was modeling. So I noted that very early on, said this can't be a coincidence. There's got to be some connection here. And at first what I thought, well, you know, maybe the reason for the magnetic reversals was that not that the magnetic field was reversing, but the mantle was moving in a fixed magnetic field. But I soon realized that we just can't have that many flips of the Earth. They're, you know, order 100, magnetic reversals. There can't be that many flips during the flood. So what I believe is that the flipping of the mantle, the motion of the mantle relative to the core, well, first of all, the core is massive, and it's going to continue to rotate. It's not going to be affected by the rotation of the mantle. The core, the outer core, is liquid, so there's to a high degree, decoupling between the motion of the core and the motion of the mantle, because the viscosity of the outer core is roughly that of water, and viscosity is so small relative to the viscosity of the rock that you can assume it's a free slip boundary. So anyway, we can assume the core just continued to rotate as it was prior to the flood. On the other hand, there is a slight conductivity, electrical conductivity, in mantle rock. So there is some, if you start moving the mantle, you're going to, the charges in the mantle are going to interact with the magnetic field. So you're going to have that kind of feedback, that kind of interaction with the magnetic field if you're moving the mantle. Probably more important is that the boundary between the core and the mantle is not perfectly smooth. There are bumps. In my view, the main effect is that you're going to significantly disturb the fluid motions in the core when you start having the mantle move over the core. And that's going to jumble the magnetic fields, the field in the core, in a conducting fluid that has a magnetic field in it. There's what is called the frozen flux approximation, namely that the magnetic flux is locked to the fluid parcels. So if you move the fluid, you drag the magnetic field lines around. So the motion of the mantle over the core is going to cause a jumbling. It's going to cause a chaotic kind of signal to be imposed on the magnetic field of the core, and I can well imagine that kind of disturbance is behind the magnetic field reversals, because the currents in the core just being a simple solenoid, there's got to be a large component of that, but because of motions in the core and the interaction between the magnetic field and the electric field, there's also got to be a lot of complexity to both the magnetic field and the electric field in the core. So I believe this flipping did disturb the core significantly, the magnetic field of the core, and did cause the magnetic reversals. That's a long answer, and I hope some of you at least were able to follow what I was saying.
Yeah, my question is on oil, peak oil versus abiotic oil. And with abiotic oil, the doctrine is that the earth generates its own oil and it's under tremendous pressure. And we saw that recently in the Gulf of Mexico. It seems to me, as creationists or as young Earth creationists, that is one of our good examples to use, that the Earth is generating its own oil under pressure, whereas the doctrine of peak oil says that, you know, the dinosaurs came and went and it was millions of years ago, and that's it, that, you know, that the oil and the coal sediments are there and that they're static and that they're not moving. I wanted your thoughts on the idea of the abiotic oil principle, because that's coming more and more into prominence when you read, you know, creation journals and all that.
Okay. I have to say I'm not a chemist. I'm not a biochemist, or I'm not an organic chemist. But to the extent that I've looked into it, I've been convinced that there are reactions that can occur in the mantle to convert carbon dioxide to organic polymers. I've been persuaded. I need to look into it more. I'm cautious about that, but at this point, I've been swayed by the arguments that sort of thing at least theoretically possible. Now, so the issue is, if it is possible, to what degree does that occur? Is that something, do we only have trace amounts of organic polymers produced, or are there, you know, zillions of barrels of equivalent of organic material produced that way? I guess from what I know, if that process were occurring at any significant level, we would be seeing evidences of it in areas where there's no sediment cover, no organic, no possibility of any organic material coming from sediments. So we'd go to cretonic areas like in Canada and Scandinavia and other parts, and look and see if we see any signal of that kind of material. And to my assessment, from my knowledge, we don't. So my position is, and again, it's not something I've looked into a lot, is that while it may be possible, abiotic origin of organic polymers is possible, I'm yet to be convinced that there's evidence that it has occurred on a large scale. So that would be my answer to that.
I have 2 points. First, back Valentine's Day a year ago, there was a major solar flare. And the results of it, according to NASA, are twofold. Number one, there was an increased movement in titanic plates and the pressure between the plates. Number two, effect was that it had changed and accelerated the alteration of the magnetic polarization, therefore increasing the need for realignment of the landing fields, et cetera, around the world, especially in North and South America. With that, they found that the result was a almost total deterioration of the magnetosphere. And so the magnetosphere has been depleted by, they estimate, over 90%.
All right. My main reaction to that is that it's not grounded in good science. I think I've seen a little bit about some of that, and my view is that it's a fraud. So I'm absolutely not aware of the Earth's magnetosphere having been degraded any kind of significant or long lasting way by any kind of recent solar flares. So I think you've must have gone to some websites where some real quacks are in operation.
Actually, that came directly off the NASA website, and it was stated in the research done by Dr. Bonley.
Okay, I don't know. I'll just say I don't know anything about it. I don't know anything about it.
Okay. The other question I had, many years ago I had a patient that was a geologist, made his money in locating oil fields. And asked him how he did it, and he said he did it by magnetic pull. Now, he started out as an atheist. He became a very devout creationist. And I asked him what the difference was, what happened. He said that the Bible refers to the separation of waters during the creation, which means that there was some separation into an ice form, whatever that means. He stayed under some physicists from Switzerland, and they believed that there was an ice matrix around the Earth prior to the flood, and that the rupturing of the ice matrix is why there was rain, as the ice came down. Number two, though, that it was able to disrupt the dirt molecules and basically pulverize on a great scale almost overnight. So is that compatible with your basis of sedimentation?
Well, there are various creationists that have proposed that the waters above were in the form of ice before the flood. First of all, from a physics standpoint, it's very difficult. You won't have a spherical distribution because there's no centrifugal force acting at the poles or high, you know, away from the equator. The force drops off. And so the only way that you would be able to have a stable configuration would be a ring of ice, sort of like the rings of Saturn. I personally think that there's no good case. I've not seen anybody make a sound case that's consistent with what I know about physics to support those kind of ideas. So I go with the view that Russ Humphreys has argued for the last 20 years, that this expanse, or the firmament, that Hebrew word rakia, as far as any close modern equivalent to that word, it would be interstellar space. It's the place, if you read Genesis 1, it's the place where the sun, moon, and stars were placed after they were created. It says at the end of the fifth day, the birds were to fly on the face of this rakia, not in the rakia, on the face of the rakia. So if it is interstellar space, then that water would be beyond the furthest galaxy today. So I do not believe, as has long been believed by creationists, that the waters above correspond to waters just above our atmosphere. My position is that those waters, if you take all those Hebrew words at face value, have to be far beyond the Earth, in effect, far beyond the most distant galaxy. So that's my position on that.
Dr. Baumgardner, I've been waiting to hear you refer to the work of Charles Hapgood in his book, The Path of the Pole.
Well, I did. I alluded to it a moment ago.
I beg your pardon if I missed that allusion. But you must have seen his book, The Path of the Pole.
I've not seen it yet. I've heard about it.
The foreword was written by Einstein himself. And I have copies of the extensive correspondence between Hapgood and Einstein personally. So what Hapgood really was trying to do was to explain the discoveries of tropic fauna and flora in fossil-bearing sediments in Antarctica, and how did it come. So that seems to very much support your story about the rapid movements of the continental plates.
Right. So in that regard, it does support catastrophic plate tectonics. But my allusion earlier, somebody asked, how would this flipping, what would have slowed it down? How could it have gone away after the flood? And I said that you only need a little, in my calculations, only put in a little bit of friction at the core mantle boundary, and that friction will slow that flipping down after, in conjunction with having this ring of cold material go from near the surface of the Earth down to the core mantle boundary. Sort of takes away its effect largely. And but I said that my calculation showed that this flipping would still go on at a slow rate beyond the year of the flood, probably a century or so, and could explain Hapgood's observations. Yeah.
Thank you.
So one thing that's encouraging is that yes, it does seem Hapgood's. I do be able to embrace and get excited about those results. Okay.
Lots of interesting concepts. I really enjoyed this. But I was kind of wondering, your position is that Pangaea was a reality right before the flood.
Something like a supercontinent. In the standard literature, that configuration is generally referred to as Panotia, okay, which existed before Pangaea.
Now, how would you explain the pristine weather patterns that must have happened during that time, since the flood, since the oceans aren't really distributed over the Earth like they are now, with all the currents equalizing the heat and whatever?
My own inadequate way of dealing with that is that we really don't know what the atmospheric regime was like. We know so little about what the Earth was like before the flood. I agree that the ocean currents do play a major role in moving heat around on the Earth today. Just what kind of regime may have been in operation at that point in Earth history, I've not looked into that. Yeah.
Right here. A couple of questions about how you initiate the model. Looking at some of the slides you had at the beginning, you had a yield stress of about 90 megapascals. Are you using an elastic, perfectly plastic type model, or are you using a brittle model? And what sets the strain in motion to cause the drift to reach such a influence that initiate the catastrophic strain?
Okay. It's challenging to do these numerical calculations. As far as the type of rheology, I'm using largely simply a viscous rheology for the mantle. With temperature dependence, if you allow the full temperature dependence, you get the surface layer way too stiff. So I limit the viscosity that I allow in that cold layer, and in addition, put a yield stress in. Rheology is a temperature dependent viscosity with yield stress. That's still much simplified from what reality is. On the other hand, it's way beyond what a lot of my contemporaries use. So that's the answer specific to your question. Did you have a second question, or was that it?
That pretty much
is. Yeah.
I'd like to thank you for offering food for thought. The science teachers in the public schools have to walk the line, and there's one state now that has a bill, and it's going to be voted on, whether the teachers are able to bring up questions about evolution and questions about other things, and so that the kids can think rather than be spoon-fed the approach. And so it's people like yourselves that really need to get together and come up with some of these things to let the young folks hear and ponder other theories rather than just what is being taught as the gospel truth in the public schools. Have you written a book?
No. I've had a book about three quarters written on catastrophic plate tectonics for 8 years. I've not finished it, mainly because I've felt like I'm somewhat on the verge of some important new results that I would like to in my book. I don't know when I'll feel like I'm...
It'll feel right.
Yeah. But, so I am more serious about getting articles out there. I have a website, and there are some articles. Most of them are too technical for most people. So I need some more popular level articles. Right. Yeah, I need, sadly, I say, you know, I mean, I consider all this pretty strategic in the spiritual war that's raging. But, you know, I moved out here after I retired from Los Alamos. I moved out here to join ICR. Well, a change of leadership took place basically after Dr. Henry Morris died, and they moved. The decision was made. The new leadership decided to move the operation to Texas, and at the same time, they basically cut loose most of the scientists. Cut loose me. John Sanford was volunteering full time. They let him, they indicated he was not welcome. Russ Humphreys left. They at one point got rid of Steve Austin. So they basically, many of us have no home.
We have a geoscience institute.
Well, like I say, I am currently essentially unsponsored. Okay, people, I mean, I don't want to build myself up, but what does it say about the priorities in the body of Christ at large when people like myself are essentially unemployed, have no source of income? Does this kind of expertise, is it not useful? I recognize, you know, God is the one that, you know, opens doors, and you know, but I'm wondering, what is this saying about?
Like all you guys are in search of an institution.
Yeah, we have no institutional support. Russ Humphreys worked for Creation Ministries International for a while, but he feels called primarily to research, and they basically treated him as a hired hand to do church talks, didn't value his research. So he said, okay, I'll just hunker down, live off my retirement income, and do what I feel God's called me to do.
Without research, there is no church talk.
Yeah, that's right. So anyway, I'll just say that sadly, or I don't know whether it's sad or not, people like us are now sort of just operating on our own. John Sanford lives on in his house in upstate New York, rural upstate New York, more or less working on his own. I'm working on my own down in Ramona, California. Anyway, I say, you know, there's in general, the church in America does not see this as a...
So it's you retired folks that are doing the research, because the working people have to make money.
Yeah.
And they're not supported in their brain work.
So that's, for whatever reason all that's happening, I don't know. I'm just...
In your lecture, you seem to be indicating that there are places in the mantle that are 3,000 degrees colder than other places in the bottom of the mantle. Has anybody done any calculations to figure out how long it would take for something that started out, let's say 5,000 degrees higher, to go to 3,000, to go to 1,000, to go to...
If there's no convective mixing, If it's simple thermal conductivity, there is a skin depth. It's very simple to calculate how rapidly the temperature decreases in a surrounding that has a different temperature. So that's a straightforward calculation to make. Yes.
And what kind of numbers do you get out of it? And are they compatible with long age?
No, it's not compatible with long age. After 100 million years, most of that temperature anomaly is going to be gone.
Okay, I have another question. What is your answer to people who believe that the data suggests that life has existed for half a million years?
Okay, well, I didn't address the age of the Earth issue in my talk in any significant way. In the past, I've worked on that because that's such an important issue. I've devoted quite a bit of it, time and energy to it over the years. I was a member of the group that's known as Radioisotopes in the Age of the Earth. There were seven of us scientists that worked on that issue of how do we explain the radioisotope data if the Earth is young. And our conclusion was, we had at least three independent lines of evidence, radioisotope evidence, that points to a young Earth. And in my opinion, the most convincing line of evidence was the fact that we find zircons in granite, the mineral zircon, zirconium silicate, because uranium substitutes readily for the zirconium atoms in that mineral, you typically find significant amounts of uranium in zircons. So those are radioactive minerals generally. And what we found was that up as much as 80% of the helium produced by the decay process, and as a U-238 decays to lead, there are 8 helium atoms produced. So the stable end products of uranium decay are lead-206, in the case of U-238, and helium. We found 80% of the helium still there in zircons that had a uranium lead age of 1.5 billion years. And so we measured the diffusion rate of helium in zircon, and we had it determined at Caltech, the best lab in the world for doing that. And based on that diffusion rate, we argue that you could not possibly retain those high levels of helium in the zircons more than just a few thousand years. And the estimate was around 6,000 years for the most likely age of those zircons based on their helium content. So that was one argument. That what we concluded then is that all of this nuclear decay that produced the helium and the lead had to have occurred during brief episodes during Earth history. Most of it had to occur during creation week, but a significant amount also had to take place during the flood. Roughly 600 million years worth had to occur during the flood. And so our basic conclusion of our rate work was that yes, there is evidence for billions of years worth of nuclear decay in the rocks of the Earth. But the assumption that the nuclear decay rates have been constant throughout Earth history is wrong. Instead, there have been two episodes, when nuclear decay rates had to be much higher. Otherwise, it had to be episodes because that much decay in a shorter time span would annihilate life. So there had to be times when life could survive. And the two periods are before life existed, on Earth, and the other time when most of the life was protected from radiation by a blanket of water. So our position on radioisotope issues is just what I just said. We had other lines of evidence that pointed to that conclusion, but there are many other lines of evidence that point to a young Earth. I would point to well-preserved soft tissue and dinosaur bones, like Mary Schweitzer published in 2005, showing flexible blood vessels and red blood cells from a T-Rex specimen that was supposedly 65 million years old. Okay? Photos of flexible blood vessels and blood cells. Okay? Another would be have to do with the one that, I don't know if John Sanford mentioned this, but the number of mutations in human mitochondrial DNA. There's only a very small number of mutations. Typically, between any two of us in the room, there's on the order of only 25 nucleotides difference in our mitochondrial DNA sequence out of 16,000 nucleotides. Only 25 are different. And an estimate for the rate of mutation is about one mutation per 10 generations. So that would say that there's only been about 250 generations in human history in all. Another thing that has been done is looking, there's so few mutations, if you sample enough of the world's population, find out what those mutations are, you can go back and put together what's called a consensus sequence, actually identify what the sequence was in the last common female ancestor to everybody alive today. And the secular world did that back about in the early 2000s and concluded that they called it mitochondrial Eve. They call that last common female ancestor mitochondrial Eve. And a lot of people objected, they estimated it was only about 6,000 years ago that mitochondrial Eve existed, because they were, you know, they had this estimate about one mutation every 10 generations. That's what it gives. So I say there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, that's a valid, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with that calculation? So there are many, I could go on, there are many lines of evidence that the Earth is young. Now, the most difficult issue for me has been the radioisotope evidence. But now I feel like we've at least got some answers. We've got some counterexamples that the secular world has no answers for on that. And of course, Paul Geim has done pointed out the radiocarbon state of affairs, that once that this accelerator mass spectrometer method came online where you actually count individual C14 atoms in a sample, eliminate the issue of cosmic radiation causing noise, it was determined that there's essentially measurable, repeatable levels of C14 in every fossil tested that still has carbon in it. And that's well documented in the radiocarbon literature. The problem with that is that the half-life of C14 is so short, you would not expect a single atom of C14 in anything older than a few hundred thousand years. Certainly, if the I've done the calculation, if the whole Earth were solid C14, after 1 million years, you would not expect a single atom to be undecayed, a single atom left after 1 million years. So finding significant levels of C14 in coal and bone and other organic materials that are, you know, 30 million or 100 million, 300 million years old, is just flies in the face of what is assumed about the age of the Earth. So C14 indicates that the Earth is not millions of years old.
How much of your geophysical model and your other research have you been able to publish widely in scientific journals? And what has been the reaction of the other scientists, especially those that are used to the more slow continental drift models?
Well, a number of my colleagues, geophysics colleagues, respect this Terra code, and so a number of people have used it, collaborated with me, and many of them have insisted having me as a co-author, since I'm the author of the software behind it all. And there was a point when I declined, but for the most part I've agreed to do that, and so that's accepted. There was while I was at Los Alamos, U.S. News and World Report did an interview with me, and they published a 4-page article based on that interview. The title was "The Geophysics of God," and they were talking about me being in the professional science community, and yet being a young Earth creationist and believing in Noah's flood, and applying pretty serious science in the big supercomputers at Los Alamos to model the flood. So, they interviewed a lot of my peers, asking them what they thought of my work and my. I was really somewhat astonished how complimentary they were of the code and the numerical work that I did, but they acknowledged they don't believe that the Earth is young, and they don't believe in Noah's flood. I'll say my peers generally aware of my position, and yet quite a few of them don't feel any problem with publishing with my name on the paper.
So they just basically don't believe in the catastrophic portion of the model, but they still believe that the model can work for their rest of their work.
And I've been kind. I haven't pointed out that the difference in the solutions has to do with the material model that's used. If they want to be more realistic with their material model, they'll get a catastrophic result. And they don't do that. They don't go there.
So you haven't pushed them in that direction then?
I've not.
Nudged?
Well.
He's afraid he's going to cause another one of those.
Okay, well.
Well, thank you very much. Let me shake your hand. All of us, I'm sure, have really, really appreciated your presentation and some of your ideas. We'll be thinking about it and talking about it for a while. Yeah, give them a hand.
Well, thank you. It's been very stimulating being with you. It's nice to have people that are tracking with me and asking such good questions. It's very stimulating to me.
There's a couple of problems with your presentation. That is, you talked about things that you could come back and talk about again sometime later. Thank you again. Okay.